how it got there.
There is a standard view about democratic societies and the role of the media within them. It's expressed, for example, by Supreme Court Justice Powell when he spoke of the crucial role of the media in affecting the societal purpose of the First Amendment, namely enabling the public to assert meaningful control over the political process. That kind of formulation expresses the understanding that democracy requires free access to information and ideas and opinion. The same conceptions hold not only with regard to the media, but with regard to educational institutions, publishing, the intellectual community generally.
It is basic to the health of a democracy that no phase of government activity escape the scrutiny of the press. Here, reporters are assigned to stories fateful not only to our nation, but to all nations. Congress, says the First Amendment, shall pass no law abridging the freedom of the press. And the chief executive himself throws open the doors of the White House to journalists representing papers of all shades of political opinion.
But it is worth bearing in mind that there is a contrary view. And in fact, the contrary view is very widely held and deeply rooted in our own civilization. It goes back to the origins of modern democracy, to the 17th century English Revolution, which was a complicated affair like most popular revolutions. There was a struggle between Parliament, representing largely elements of the gentry and the merchants, and the royalists, representing other elite groups, and they fought it out. But like many popular revolutions, there was also a lot of popular ferment going on that was opposed to all of them. There were popular movements that were questioning everything: the relation between master and servant, the right of authority altogether. All kinds of things were being questioned. There was a lot of radical publishing. The printing presses had just come into existence. And this disturbed all the elites on both sides of the Civil War. So as one historian pointed out at the time in 1660, he criticized the radical Democrats, the ones who were calling for what we would call democracy, because they are making the people so curious and so arrogant that they will never find humility enough to submit to a civil rule. Now, underlying these doctrines, which were very widely held, is a certain conception of democracy. It's a game for elites. It's not for the ignorant masses who have to be marginalized, diverted, and controlled, of course, for their own good. The same principles were upheld in the American colonies. The dictum of the founding fathers of American democracy that, I'm quoting, the people who own the country ought to govern it, quoting John Jay. Now, in modern times, for elites, this contrary view about the intellectual life and the media and so on, this contrary view, in fact, is the standard one, I think, apart from rhetorical flourishes.
From Washington, D.C., he's intellectual, author, and linguist, Professor Noam Chomsky. Manufacturing Consent. What is that title meant to describe?
Well, the title is actually borrowed from a book by Walter Lippmann, written back around 1921, in which he described what he called the manufacture of consent as a revolution in the practice of democracy. What it amounts to is a technique of control. And he said this was useful and necessary because the common interests, the general concerns of all people, elude the public. The public just isn't up to dealing with them. And they have to be the domain of what he called a specialized class. Notice that that's the opposite of the standard view about democracy. There's a version of this expressed by the highly respected moralist and theologian Reinhold Niebuhr, who was very influential on contemporary policymakers. His view was that rationality belongs to the cool observer, but because of the stupidity of the average man, he follows not reason but faith. And this naive faith requires necessary illusion and emotionally potent oversimplifications, which are provided by the myth maker to keep the ordinary person on course. It's not the case, as the naive might think, that indoctrination is inconsistent with democracy. Rather, as this whole line of thinkers observes, it's the essence of democracy. The point is that in a military state or a feudal state or what we would nowadays call a totalitarian state, it doesn't much matter what people think, because you've got a bludgeon over their head and you can control what they do. But when the state loses the bludgeon, when you can't control people by force, and when the voice of the people can be heard, you have this problem. It may make people so curious and so arrogant that they don't have the humility to submit to a civil rule, and therefore you have to control what people think. And the standard way to do this is the resort to what in more honest days used to be called propaganda, manufacture of consent, creation of necessary illusions, various ways of either marginalizing the general public or reducing them to apathy in some fashion.
The oldest of two boys, Avram Noam Chomsky, was born in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania in 1928. As a Jewish child, the anti-Semitism of the time affected him. Both parents taught Hebrew, and he became fascinated by literature, reading translations of French and Russian classics. He also took an interest in a grammar book written by his father on Hebrew of the Middle Ages. He recalls a childhood absorbed in reading, curled up in a sofa, often borrowing up to 12 books at once from the library. He is married to Carol, and they have three children.
I don't like to impose on my wife and children a form of life that they certainly haven't selected for themselves, namely one of public exposure or exposure to the public media. That's their choice, and I don't believe that they have themselves selected this. I don't impose it on them. I would like to protect them from it, frankly. Second, a sort of perhaps principled point is that I'm rather against the idea, the whole notion of developing public personalities who are treated as stars of one kind or another, where aspects of their personal life are supposed to have some significance and so on.
Take one in the reception room.
You said that you were just like us. You went to school, got good grades, and what made you start being critical, you know, and seeing the different? What started the change?
You know, well, you know, there are all kinds of personal factors in anybody's life. I mean, first of all, don't forget I grew up in a depression. My parents actually happened to have jobs, which was kind of unusual. They were Hebrew school teachers, so sort of lower middle class. For them, everything revolved around being Jewish, Hebrew and Palestine in those days and so on. And I grew up in that milieu. So, you know, I learned Hebrew and went to Hebrew school, became a Hebrew school teacher, went to Hebrew college, led youth groups, summer camps, Hebrew camps, the whole business. The branch of the Zionist movement that I was part of was all involved in socialist binationalism and Arab-Jewish cooperation and all sorts of nice stuff.